Good evening, everybody. Welcome to our Good Friday service. Can any of you kids tell me, what are we remembering? What are we celebrating on Good Friday? Yeah, Marcel?
That Jesus died on the cross.
That Jesus died on the cross, yeah. So tonight we'll be reflecting on that and on the significance of his death. You all got candles as you came in. If you didn't, there's a basket back there. You can go get one. There's not a special time that you're supposed to have your candles on and off. It's just up to you and your discretion of when you want to. But Haley, don't be careful. Don't burn the church down. Okay? All right. Let's pray, and then we'll begin our service and just this time of reflection and also celebration. You know, we call it Good Friday, which is always kind of a funny title, right? Because it's good for us, but when we think of what Jesus endured, it's also hard, and just the reminder that goodness came through suffering. So let's pray and let's move into this time. God, we thank you for this day. It truly is good, God. God, it is the goodness of God that sent Jesus to us. It is his goodness and his love for us that led him to endure the cross. It's your goodness that has called us and your good grace that has brought us to repentance and into your kingdom. And so this is a good day. And yet we're reminded today that many good things have a very horrible cost. And so may we hold both of those things in tension today as we look to the cross. May we be reminded of the suffering that it took and the goodness that was accomplished through that suffering, God. We thank you for your Son and for the cross of Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There are two ways of seeing this picture that's not popping up. Hang on a second. Not sure what's going on. Let's try this again. All right, there are two ways of seeing this picture. What do you see in this picture? Yeah, Tori? A bird. What do you see, Marcel?
A bunny.
Yep, there's two ways of seeing this picture. You might see a rabbit, or you might see a bird or a duck. When we look at it, we can see two different things there. In the same way, there's two ways to see this picture as well. Some, when they look at it, see just a good teacher wrongly accused. Some see a symbol of a fight against injustice. Some see a crazy man. And some see a king. Tonight, we're going to ask ourselves, what do we see when we look at the cross?
Cross, the emblem of suffering and
And he said to them, "He who has ears, let him hear." Jesus spoke those words to his disciples, and they are us as well. He who has ears, let him hear. Jesus spoke these words after sharing a parable with his disciples. He told them the story of a farmer who planted seed. Some of the seed fell on a rocky path, some on bad soil, and some on good. The point of Jesus' story was encouraging us to let his words fall in soil that would grow and have life in our hearts. But after sharing this story, he made an interesting statement. He said this: "To you has been given the mystery of the kingdom of God. But for those outside, everything is in parables, so that they may indeed see, but not perceive, and may indeed hear, but not understand." Jesus spoke of two types of listeners, two types of seers, two types of hearers. Those who would see and perceive, see and understand, and hear and understand. In Greek, to speak of a mystery is not the same as in English. If in English I say something is a mystery, it means it's unknown. There's a crime, someone disappears. We say it's a mystery what happened. We don't know. But that is not what Jesus meant when he said a mystery had been given to the disciples. In Greek, the word refers not to what is not unknown, but what has been made known, what has been revealed. And so what Jesus is saying to his disciples here is that there are two types of seers, those to whom the truth of who he is and what he has come for has been revealed, and those who are unable to see. For one group, they see Jesus and all that he does, his ministry, his love, his death, and his resurrection. And in all those things, truth has been revealed. For others, they see, but do not perceive. They hear, but do not understand. Their mind remains shrouded to what has been revealed in him.
The Christ by man rejected, yes, my soul, 'tis his, 'tis he. 'Tis the long expected prophet, David's son, yet David's Lord. By his son, God now has spoken, 'tis the true and faithful. Tell me, ye who hear him groaning, was there ever grief like his? Friends to fear his cause disowning, foes insulting his distress. Many hands were raised to wound him, none would interpose to save, but the deepest stroke that pierced him was the stroke that justice gave. Ye who think of sin but lightly, nor suppose the evil great, here may view its nature rightly, here its guilt may estimate. Mark the sacrifice appointed, see who bears the awful load. 'Tis the word the Lord's anointed, Son of Man and Son of God. Here we have a firm foundation, hear the refuge of the lost. Christ the rock of our salvation is the name of which we boast. Lamb of God, poor sinners wounded, sacrifice to cancel guilt. None shall ever be confounded who on him their hope have built.
Jesus and his disciples left Galilee and went up to the villages near Caesarea Philippi. As they were walking along, he asked them, Who do people say I am? Well, they replied, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and others say you're one of the prophets. And then he asked them, but who do you say that I am? Peter replied, you're the Messiah. But Jesus warned them not to tell anyone about him. Who do you say that I am? The truth had been revealed to Peter. He knew who Jesus was, that Jesus was the Messiah, the Christ, the expected king who had come to save his people. And yet Jesus' response to Peter seems very strange. Why would he tell Peter and the disciples to keep it a secret? We see the answer in what happens next. Then Jesus began to tell them that the Son of Man must suffer many terrible things and be rejected by the elders, the leading priests, and the teachers of religious law. he would be killed, but 3 days later he would rise from the dead. As he talked about this openly with his disciples, Peter took him aside and began to reprimand him for saying such things. Jesus turned around and looked at his disciples and then reprimanded Peter. "Get away from me, Satan," he said. "You're seeing things merely from a human point of view, not from God." The truth had been revealed to Peter, but only in part. He could see that Jesus was the Messiah, but all that meant, the truth of a Messiah who came and suffered, that was a hard message to hear. It was not the message he had heard for his whole life, of a Messiah who comes and conquers. He could not comprehend a Messiah that conquered through suffering and death. An equally difficult teaching is what Jesus spoke next. Calling the crowd to join his disciples, he said, "If any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way. Take up your cross and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you will lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake and for the sake of the good news, you will save it. And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? Is anything worth more than your soul?" Jesus said that anyone that wanted to follow him, to be a part of his kingdom, to serve him as a king, must suffer like he would suffer. I think for many of us, we can be like Peter here. This message is a little more than we really can grasp. It's not what we've always heard. We cannot comprehend that we are not called to comfort, but to suffering. Not to ease, but to difficulty. Not only to life, but life through death. I wonder if we understand the full message that has been given to us. If we see and truly perceive. If we hear and truly understand. Do we really understand the cost of following Jesus? Has it fully been revealed to us?
Survey the wondrous cross.
They took Jesus to the high priest's home, where the leading priests, the elders, and the teachers of religious law had gathered. Many false witnesses spoke against him. They contradicted each other. Then the high priest stood up before the others and asked Jesus, "Well, aren't you going to give an answer to these charges? What do you have to say for yourself?" But Jesus was silent and made no reply. And then the high priest asked him, "Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?" As the high priest speaks to Jesus, he asks him a question. And in English, we lose a little bit of irony here, because the words spoken by the high priest are the same as those of Peter. "You are the Messiah." The high priest utters the truth without even realizing its meaning. He is not the only one. The world is full of eyes that see but do not perceive. "You are the King of the Jews," Pilate will later declare, and hang a sign on his cross that says the same. Similarly, the soldiers took Jesus into the courtyard of the governor's headquarters, called the Praetorium, and called out the entire regiment. They dressed him in a purple robe, and they wove thorn branches into a crown and put it on his head. And then they saluted him and taunted him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they struck him on the head with a reed stick and spit on him and dropped to their knees in mock worship. And when they were finally tired of mocking him, they took off the purple robe and put his own clothes on him again. And then they led him away to be crucified. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. A sign announced the charge against him. It read, "The King of the Jews." Two revolutionaries were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. The people passing by shouted abuse, shaking their heads in mockery. "Ha! Look at you now," they yelled. "You said you're going to destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days. Well then, save yourself. Come down from the cross." The leading priests and teachers of religious law also mocked Jesus. "He saved others," they scoffed, "but he can't even save himself. Let this Messiah, this King of Israel, come down from the cross so we can see it and believe him." Seeing, they did not believe. There are two ways of seeing the cross: a tragedy or a triumph. A victory for evil killing an innocent man, or the victory of a king conquering an evil world. What do you see as you look at the cross? What do you see as you look at Jesus' body broken? What do you see as you look at his blood spilled out on the ground? Ask yourself this question as you come and receive communion and take it back to your seats, and we'll take it together. you, who do you say I am? God, I pray for us today. I pray that you would open our eyes to see you for all who you are. That you would open our eyes to see the cross for all that it is. For the wondrous victory accomplished on it. For our sin, for our life, for your creation. And the wondrous cross and the wondrous suffering that took place there. May we not just with our lips say that you are the Christ, you are the Messiah, you are a King, but may we understand fully what that means. We take this bread and worship of our King who came for us. And God, as we look to the cross today, may we not just see our King and his suffering, but see the calling that he has placed upon us to come and follow, to be crucified to the world, to carry our cross, to be willing to enter into a world of suffering, and display our King to it. We take this cup and we say thank you for the gift of Christ, for the salvation that came from the cross, and ask for you to open our eyes and open our hearts to be willing to follow and suffer as well. At noon, darkness fell across the whole land until 3:00. Then at 3:00, Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you abandoned me?" Some of the bystanders misunderstood and thought he was calling for the prophet Elijah. One of them ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, holding it up on a reed stick so he could drink. "Wait," he said, "let's see if Elijah comes to take him down." Then Jesus uttered another loud cry and breathed his last. And the curtain of the sanctuary of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the Roman officer who stood facing him saw how he had died, he exclaimed, "This man truly was the Son of God." The message tonight might seem a little bit fatalistic. Either your eyes are opened or they're not. But that's not the point of this story. Eyes can still be opened. Those who only see can still understand. We're given the testimony of this Roman soldier at the cross, standing there at the feet of Jesus. Perhaps he had taken part of the mocking earlier, mockingly saying, "You are the King," to Jesus. And now he looks up at Jesus and he declares, "Truly, this man was the Son of God." God opens eyes. God has opened our eyes. The veil has come off. The truth has been revealed. Perhaps you're here and you don't know that Jesus is King. And like Peter, God is lifting your eyes to the truth. Perhaps you do know that And God is just opening your eyes to deeper truths of what it means to follow him and to come and suffer and die. Either way, the fact that we are here tonight is a reminder of the hope that we have in Christ. The eyes do not stay veiled. Ears do not stay plugged. We can see and perceive. We can hear and understand. God opened eyes then, and he's opening eyes today. And he has opened our eyes. Let's sing one more song and celebrate the joy that God has opened our eyes to the truth of who he is.
He is the King of
God, we thank you for our Savior. We thank you for the cross. God, we pray that you would open our eyes to see it rightly, to see our King who came to suffer and conquer death. And may we follow him always. We thank you for the cross. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Grace be with you all. You feel free to visit for a little bit, and after a few minutes, we're going to start setting up for Sunday. So if anyone wants to stick around and help set up tables, you can do that as well.